Hi, I'm Professor Rex Kuntz, and today we're going to talk about themes in Latin American visual culture. And by that I mean we're not going to do a straight history. We're not going to do a sort of chronological overview of Latin American visual culture, but we're going to hit on some of what I think are the most important historical contexts and the most important theoretical concerns that one should have in mind when approaching a work of Latin American art. And we're going to talk a lot about art too, but I do use the term visual culture consciously and with a reason in mind. But we're going to see that as the lecture sort of progresses and specifically as we get towards the end of the lecture. Now, the way I wanted to approach this was to jump right in with what I think is probably the most iconic set of people and images. And if we could just bring those up rather than look at me. All right. You probably already know these people. I mean, one of the most interesting things about teaching and discussing Latin American art of the last 100 years is it has become so central in a lot of worldwide discussions of art and politics and society. And through the efforts largely of this couple and their worldwide really exploits. That's of course Diego Rivera on the right in the photograph and Frida Kahlo on the left. And those two individuals, more than anybody else in Latin America, were responsible for bringing Latin American art and visual cultures, we'll talk about, into a much wider consciousness, into a much wider public. To understand specifically the output of Diego Rivera, we're going to talk about him at length here, you really have to think about the context in which he painted. Rivera was a product of the 1920s. That's where he did his most important work. That's where he really entered the world stage in a way that few Latin American artists have before or since. And it shaped him in turn. Of course, the 1920s were the time that Mexico, as a revolutionary country, and the revolutionary government set up more stable, more lasting institutions, and specifically wanted to communicate a particular visual idea of what the revolution was. They wanted to create a visual identity. And they did this consciously. This is the absolute fascinating part for me. And the chronology of it, the sort of context of it, is complex. But I want to focus on a few things. The movement that attempted to define the Mexican Revolution visually, we call now Mexican muralism. Of course, it wasn't called that at the time. But looking back, that's what we give the name to this movement, the artists that included Diego Rivera, and the institutional support that was given those artists in specifically in the 1920s. Well, Diego Rivera studied, in fact, he was not a participant in the revolution. This is an interesting side note. He was in Paris during the entire revolutionary moment. He left Mexico in 1907, just as things were beginning to, of course, come to a head. And he was not called back from Europe until 1920. Now, when he was called back by the Mexican government, who initially gave him the scholarship to go study in France in the first place. He was called back to help create a sort of visual identity again for the Mexican government, for the revolution, to give shape, visual shape to this incredible transformation of the country. The art was specifically to embody the New Mexico, and he was coming in under the aegis of, and really under the tutelage of, a very important intellectual called José Vasconcelos. Have we talked about Vasconcelos in the revolution? Well, let me talk a little bit about Vasconcelos. He was a political radical in the sense that he was very committed to large-scale education, large-scale popular education. He was made Secretary of Education in 1920 and served in that post from 1920 to 1924. And in 1925, sort of as the summation of his experiences attempting to set up the first large-scale public educational system in Mexico, he published a book called that still has resonance for people and still, in fact, is part of our common cultural parlance. He called it La Raza Cosmica, in which he argued that the Americas were really the seat of the cradle of a new race of people that were going to develop a new beauty, a new sense of beauty, a new society, not the sort of exclusionary European politics that we had seen previously. That the Mexican Revolution was a harbinger of much larger developments that were going to be enacted by this new sort of fifth race of humans. Of course, the whole idea of race now is incredibly problematic, but Vasconcelos used it with aplomb, used it without any doubts whatsoever, and gave them really the big impetus for the valuation of mestizo at the center of Mexican cultural politics comes through no small part in this book. Now, for us as visual people, as art historians, what's interesting about this whole Vasconcelos and his bringing Ribera and getting some other artists together and attempting to create this new visual vocabulary is that he believes that he is forging, sort of by fiat, by patronage, he's forging this new ideal, this new sense of beauty that he is eventually going to write about in La Raza Cosmica. What is extremely interesting for later develops is Vasconcelos was not interested in purely political art. He was not interested in having Ribera talk about the march of history in a Marxist sense. He wasn't interested in Ribera painting a lot of revolutionary workers triumphing over the evil forces of 19th century mercantilism and capitalism. He was interested in patronizing an art that was going to, in fact, create a new sense of beauty. He's very, very big on this, that the new race needed a new sense of beauty. The Greeks and the Greco-Roman world had created the old European race's sense of beauty, and now we're going to get a new one. As Ribera came back and more or less showed his cards that he was going to politicize this process, that he was going to talk specifically about political events in his art, this disappointed Vasconcelos to no small extent. So there's already a lot of tension in the early 20s about how to define the visual identity of Mexico and of the Mexican Revolution. For Ribera, it really is, and if we could get this up again, for Diego Rivera and for several of the other artists that we're going to talk about later, the Mexican muralist movement, this idea of painting for the people, had to deal with history. It had to, in fact, embody some sense of historical progress and the need for revolution and the outcome of the revolution. In this sense, he was a Marxist, and he proclaimed himself so constantly. Yes.
Do you mean Vasconcelos considered himself a Marxist?
Or no, thank you. Ribera. No, Ribera.
Okay,
Vasconcelos was not. I mean, he was obviously interested in theories that talked about oppressed peoples, but he was not a Marxist, a dogmatic Marxist. And in fact, Ribera is actually coming much more out of the salon culture of Europe in the 20s. And he knew Antoine Breton, and he knew a lot of these other people who were committed Marxists and artists. And so he's importing sort of a foreign way of looking at political history. Certainly in the visual culture, in the salons of the visual artists, he was importing something that hadn't been front and center. Right. This is a slightly later work, his murals for the Palacio Nacional, in which he actually maps out the conquest to the revolution as a visual panorama. It really is all about the history. And as you can see in the upper, well, in the mid-right section, there's a large red bandana that says Huelga, strike. There's a lot of references to workers' movements, to the oppressed paisanos, and to the sorts of remedies then that the revolution is going to propose, and specifically a sort of heroicization of those figures who led to the revolution. It's a very tendentious, very alluring vision of Mexican history. And this for Rivera as a Marxist artist, this was very important, to map out for the people a vision of history that includes a sort of progressive march to their empowerment, to the rise of the revolutionary government that eventually represents them. In doing this, though, there are a couple of things in play that Ribeiro was very conscious of. In doing this, he needed to invent a new vocabulary. Mexican art before Ribeiro was certainly not about speaking to large masses of people, right? It was just like European art. It was a salon culture with oil on canvas. You went to galleries. They had great museums. Still in Mexico City, there are just fantastic museums. There was a very rich art culture that did not include speaking to large masses of people. There was also a very rich, cheap print culture. You're probably familiar with the prints of Posada, for example, that were distributed widely, but those two didn't meet very much. And what Ribeiro wanted to do is to bring these two together to create a monumental art, not just prints, but a monumental art that communicated to large masses of people. And this is exactly what Mexican muralism then did. And it did so by, in fact, embodying some really interesting stylistic conventions that Ribeiro thought about while he was in Europe. When he was in Europe, that very last year he was in Europe, he knew he was being called back to create this new art. And there was no language for this. It's kind of like you're asked to create a new spoken language for someone, and there's no model for it. There's no culture for it in Mexico. So Ribeiro took a trip to Italy, and he fell in love with the medieval Christian mural tradition, specifically Giotto, but a lot of other people in medieval Christian art. And he thought, and I think quite rightly, that medieval Christian muralism was in one way very much akin. It was a sister project to what he wanted to do. It was a mural art that spoke to the illiterate. It was an art that spoke to large masses of people, and it was an art that that attempted to seduce people into a vision of the truth. All of those things is exactly what he wanted to do. He just had no interest in Christian proselytizing. He had no interest in telling those sorts of sacred stories. His sacred story was the idea, of course, of the march of the proletariat to ever more power, ever more control over their own environment. So that those frescoes that we saw, the Palacio Nacional history, really is a secularized, politicized vision of a medieval fresco program. And that's going to be very important later on. And he knew, there are journal entries in which he says this is really what Mexico needs. They need something like great medieval European frescoes. But this dogmatic, perhaps, very politicized Marxist vision of history, of course, began to rub up against the political realities of the time. And after 1930, when he finished his National Palace murals, he fell out of favor with the political establishment in Mexico. So after 1930, while he was still lionized, he was still an iconic figure in Mexico culturally, he had no political power, he had no in with the government, and therefore he got no commissions. To the amount of commissions Diego Rivera has in the public sphere in Mexico after 1930 is minuscule. It's tiny, which is kind of interesting. People don't often think that actually it's only the first 9 or 10 years of Diego Rivera's productive life in which he's really painting for the people of Mexico. The rest of the time, he's off doing other things. Specifically, and this is the most interesting and sort of tension-filled and in many ways cinematic part of our story. He spent the entire early 30s hobnobbing with the great American industrialists. Specifically, Henry Ford, whom we all know, right? And John Rockefeller. These were his two great patrons in the early 30s. And that seems almost, well, it seems ridiculous on the face of it, one might think. But actually, Henry Ford was incredibly sympathetic to many of Ribetta's stated goals. Ford, remember, is the person who decided that if you paid the workers enough to have them buy your car, you were going to sell a lot more cars, right? And so he actually does and you're seeing just one wall of this on the screen, he actually does an enormous fresco cycle for the Detroit Institute of the Arts, paid for entirely by Henry Ford. And it's still there. It's one of his great accomplishments. If you want to see some of the best Diego Rivera, you actually have to go to Detroit, which is kind of interesting. These Detroit murals did not broadcast his vision of the workers gaining ever more control and ever more power as much as it simply celebrated Fordist factory practices and the march of technological progress. So it was a little less politicized on the worker versus patron or versus bourgeois or versus the people who own the factories. After all, he was being paid by Henry Ford. But it's a great pion. Stylistically, it's probably one of the most coherent, integral things that Ribetta did, is this pion to factory workers and the beauty of the factory. And this Ford got into. I mean, this absolutely rang Ford's bell. He loved his factories. He thought they were sort of works of art at this same time. And in fact, you have one of the greatest American photographers of the first half of the 20th century, Charles Sheeler, working for Ford, photographing these things. And these become icons of modern art, his photographs. So you have a lot of this going on. Ribetta was constantly in the front pages of the New York Times and the Detroit Press and all of the American papers, sort of working with Ford on this. And so in 1933, he moves to New York, and he is chosen to be the decorator of one of the main foyers of the new Rockefeller Center. And you probably have all seen that in the show 30 Rock or on the New Year's Day things, Christmas celebrations. And that was going to be a Ribetta commission. But Ribetta, I think, and quite wisely, quite sort of like the cagey man that he was, manipulated the media so that it was a Rockefeller versus Rivera scenario. In that Diego, and this is the masterwork of what was going to be the foyer of the entry to the Rockefeller Center. It's called Man Controller of the Universe, or when he was doing it for Rockefeller, he kept calling it Man at the Crossroads. But this particular mural was about the harnessing of energy, the human ability to harness energy. And then I think what the subtext was, of course, what that begs the question, harness the energy for what? And this is where Rockefeller and Ribetta could not see eye to eye. Because Rockefeller was very interested in people who were going to harness the energy, like here's Ribetta and Trotsky on the lower right. Harness energy for the good of the workers. In fact, Trotsky is immediately above that photo that you see. Lenin is immediately above and to your left of that photo as well. And Rockefeller could not stomach Lenin and Trotsky being in the center of his, you know, greatest building achievement. And that, in that sense, he was probably a little more reactionary than Ford. But I also think that Diego was specifically pushing him to sort of make a choice one way or another. Are you going to basically legitimate the communist revolution in Russia in the foyer of the greatest capitalist building of the 1930s? Or are you going to have me paint over it and I'm going to get an enormous amount of excellent press off it. And the, of course, the number two, choice number two, is what happened. Rockefeller, and he looked a lot like a uncultured goon, but Rockefeller then made Rubetta paint over it. The American intellectual establishment got up in arms. There were a lot of very mean articles written on Rockefeller, a lot of really excellent caricatures done on Rockefeller around that time. And basically, Rubetta went away, but he went away as a total hero to the American arts establishment. It's very important to see the WPA and all of the great American mural art in the context of this particular scenario, because this really sparked an enormous renaissance in American muralism throughout the rest of the 30s. So Rubetta and in fact, Mexican muralism in general can be seen to be one of the crucial cornerstones, something that engendered that a very socially conscious American art of the time, which, by the way, was also helped by Roosevelt and the New Deal, and all, had the same sort of governmental support that Rivera had found 10 years earlier in Mexico, but no longer had, interestingly, enough. One of the great dangers of thinking about Mexican muralism and seeing it specifically through the, I believe the in the 1940s, Bertram Wolf wrote a sort of hagiography, a biography of Diego Rivera called The Fabulous Life of Diego Rivera. And it was the standard reading material for Diego Rivera studies for, well, much too long. Actually, it was laudatory. I mean, Diego was this hero. He was a womanizer who was yet, you know, had so many sort of creative abilities that you could not, you really couldn't blame him for anything that he did. But it's dangerous to sort of see everything through Rubetta. I mean, one of the really interesting things to get into is the competition amongst people who wanted to define the Mexican Revolution and the later revolutionary government visually, because you not only have Rubetta on our left here, but you have who I think is a very important painter, José Clemente Orozco. On your right, this is Christ destroying his cross, you can see that, from 1943, who took a much more somber, much more expressionistic view of the revolution. Orozco was very interested in the actual suffering, degradation, and chaos created by the revolution and how heroic it was to work oneself out of that. Orozco had beside Orozco, Rivera looks incredibly clean, very sort of modernist, and very, everything sort of pointed to a great goal that we're about to obtain. Whereas Orozco was really in some ways, a very old Mexican visual trope, and that is the trope of suffering. The idea of suffering as a center, a focal point of artistic expression. And Orozco actually creates a whole body of work in the 20s and 30s and 40s that documents not the heroic outcome of the revolution, but the suffering and chaos engendered by the revolution and what that really meant. That in fact Mexico was in many ways a country born of suffering. And his absolute masterpiece, the Hospicio Cabañas in Guadalajara, is painted in the late 30s, is an amazing investigation of suffering, pain, oppression as Mexican history. Not in Mexican history, but as Mexican history. And that's where you get the sort of iconic Man in Flames, the Hombre en Llamas, that is in fact the cupola mural of that. If you haven't seen that, there's no, sadly, there's no copyright-free image of that, so we can't show that. It would be going against the law. But if you haven't seen the Hospicio Cabañas program, and specifically the Man in Flames, the great dome mural of that, please go check it out after this class, because it's a completely different vision of the revolution. And to sort of prove my point, I'm going to go back to the first image that we saw of Mexican muralism that you see again on your screen. This is Riveras en el Arsenal. You can see the title from 1928. That was actually painted in the Ministry of Public Education, in the ministry that Vasconcelos set up, and is still the greatest example of muralism. And you can see that there's a lot. It's first of all, it's very heroic. Everyone's standing, waving flags, holding guns. These are people in motion, dynamic, ready to go fight the good fight, and fight the good fight for the best of reasons. That is the freeing the oppressed working class. You can even see a hammer and sickle flag in the background. Of course, on your right, you see dressed in the red sort of communist garb shirt. Who is that? I mean, I think that, can anybody recognize who he is painting? This is not a generalized. Frida, exactly. Yeah, it's so obvious that one almost doesn't want to say it. But yeah, of course, it's Frida Kahlo. In fact, there's a really famous Italian photographer there. Tina Modotti is also in that particular image. The point is, he is not only is he heroicizing the revolution, but he's actually lionizing, canonizing figures that are right there in the cultural scene and associating them directly with revolutionary movements and leftist politics, etc., by 1928. So he's really creating a contemporary mythology, if one can call it that, of the revolution. But that's exactly what he was called on to do. That's exactly his charge, is to create a contemporary visual mythology for the revolution. Orozco never achieved the sort of status that Ribera had because he did not create that sort of visual mythology. Or he, in some ways, he did create a visual mythology, but not one that one wanted to jump up and down and go rah-rah about. But it was a much deeper sort of emotional and almost physical exploration of what the revolution was to the people who lived through it. So let's go back just one more time to this comparison, and you can see again the sort of clean heroic lines of the Rivera on our left and the expressionistic, much more broadly painted, and by that I mean you can see the touch of the artist in the work, and that always brings in an emotional content that one doesn't have with the cleanly painted, sort of almost overly intellectualized, or certainly intellectualized, Ribera work. And that distinction was very important for those artists. They really viewed themselves as completely different representatives, completely different interpreters of the Mexican experience. Now, all of this must be seen in light of what went on just before. I mean, one of the most interesting things, and there was a great show a couple of years ago, is that if you want to look at early Ribera, you're going to look at something like what is there on the left. And this is actually an early attempt at capturing visually the Mexican Revolution. This is called Zapatista Landscape, obviously, from 1915, on your left. And it is anything but an easily or legible, easily read narrative about heroic people going off and fighting the good fight. This is an exploration of what it means to represent something. And in that, he was totally European, which makes sense because he was living in Paris. He was good friends with Picasso. He was good friends with Amedeo Modigliani, who is one of the people in that Met show at the MFAH right now, actually did a portrait of Rivera, which is quite good. The point is, he was part and parcel of the Paris art scene and interested in a lot of these same things, like you see a Picasso drawing on your right, in a style that we call Cubist. Cubist because what these people were interested in doing is sort of taking apart the visual experience that happens over time for us and breaking it down into little planes of visual experience, like one moment I see this, another moment I see that. And that's why it's so faceted and broken up and so, in many ways, hard to read, because it's really about how we experience an object over time. It's not meant to be easily legible all in one go. Now, you can see why when Diego then gets this call or letter in 1919 saying, okay, it's time to come back, we're going to create a new visual language, 1919-1920, you can see why he would say, well, I'm going to go back to Mexico and I'm going to then, you know, wow them, seduce them with this Cubist style, and they're going to understand everything about the Mexican Revolution through this Cubist style. That's not going to work. He knew that wasn't going to work. In fact, most French people didn't know what was going on with Cubism. There was a lot of virulent critique of the illegibility, the hermetic quality, the sort of over-intellectualization of this movement. So that's where Rivetta was, really, in the teens. He was in Paris exploring modes of representation, exploring what it meant to represent with his good friends, some of the most avant-garde, some of the most advanced artists in the world. And you can even go back further. And in fact, this is something that he did on your right, right as he arrived in Paris, which is really sort of saccharine sweet turn of the century, turn of the 1900. Art, very representational, but very much about portraiture and elegance and this sort of thing. So Rivetta cannot be said to have come out of, say, a sort of teenage experience with this idea of muralism fully formed. In fact, it was a long road for him. It literally took him 13 years of intensive sort of searching to then, and then be asked, be sort of given this opportunity to come up with the idea and the style of muralism. Now, one of the great misconceptions, and perhaps I'm misjudging people, but one of the things that a lot of people I talk to about muralism tell me is, oh, well, he was going back to pre-Columbian practices. You know, he's going back to Teotihuacan or other pre-Columbian societies. And it's very clear, once one really puts these things side by side, that Rivetta had little or no interest in pre-Columbian style for his own practice. He was a great collector of pre-Columbian art. But there's a Teotihuacan mural on your left, Rivetta mural on your right, and there's simply no stylistic concordance whatsoever. I mean, they're just completely different styles. For that matter, there were several different styles working in pre-Columbian, several different major stylistic categories working in pre-Columbian art, none of which look anything like a Diego Rivetta mural. Right? So what he was interested in is the fact that people painted on walls in pre-Columbian cultures. And they did that to announce things to the people. Now that interested him to no small extent. What he was not interested in is taking pre-Columbian style and then using it to create a new Mexican style. Again, what he did really was to take Giotto and some of the great Christian medieval muralists from Europe and sort of ratchet their style to his liking and develop a sort of mature muralism. Yes?
I'm by no means an art scholar, so can you explain how this medieval Christian art fit into his, I guess, communism and political activism? And what, I mean, was he an atheist?
Yeah, well, he said he was. Uh-huh. So yes, okay. I assume he was. That's a great question. Now, so how does, and on the face of it, it seems ridiculous. I mean, what is this guy? Marxism in the early 20th century was a very anti-religious thing. They took Marx's quote, "Religion is the opiate of the people," and they really attempted to apply it. And the revolution itself was extremely hard on priests and the sort of wealth that the church had accumulated and all of that. We know all that. So he was going with a particular flow there, but when he looked at a Christian medieval mural, he saw people who could paint stories, and stories of a progressive, didactic nature, and could make people, peasants, illiterate people, the general people, they could make these stories come to life. What he really did is he replaced the stories of Christian salvation with Marxist salvation. He replaced the saints structurally with the leftist martyrs and heroes. And he rolled out muralism in exactly that way. And one of the things one could come back and say was, well, you know, what a kind of derivative guy. But the fact is, he was tired of trying to always do something new, and he wanted to communicate. He wanted to talk to the people. And how do you talk? You don't talk to the people by slamming them with a language they don't know. I mean, actually, that was one of the big criticisms of the church. It was Latin mumbo jumbo. Nobody understood anything. You weren't communicating with the people in a language they could understand. Diego was very wise in the ways of media manipulation, as we saw. He knew that he had to forge a language that these people could hook into. He had to forge a story that these people could, even if they didn't agree, they could sort of see how the saints and the leftist heroes were the same, and they could make that switch very easily. And so what he does is he structurally transforms a language that's already there, that's already ready to go for him. And in some ways, of course, the medieval mural tradition had already traveled to Mexico. And it was all over the 16th century monasteries, but by that time they had been painted over for various reasons, a lot of different reasons. That's the whole colonial, of course, we're just completely ignoring the colonial history of Mexico, which is deep, rich, profound, but really is in some ways not at issue here with Rivera because he's not paying any attention to it. Although in that way, it was too part of the equation. In fact, what's interesting is it's Frida Kahlo who pays a lot of attention to colonial art, whereas Diego doesn't. In some ways, he feels it's tainted. The whole colonial experience is tainted because it has such a close connection with the Spanish. And so he discounts colonial history and he discounts colonial art forms for that very reason. It's his consort, Frida, who is constantly saying and constantly doing in her art, you really should look at the colonial visual heritage of Mexico. And Diego is kind of like, that's not heroic enough for him. He's either pre-Columbian or modern revolutionary. It's a very interesting dichotomy that they played out politically and visually on those two. Now what happens though is that there's a certain sort of orthodoxy then that Mexican muralism establishes in Mexican art, in the Mexican art world over the 30s and 40s. If you don't paint murals that have an uplifting effect on the people, then you shouldn't be doing art. And you certainly won't be getting any government money, right? And what of course that does to young Mexican artists is it makes them angry, it makes them feel like they're being choked, and it makes them feel like they are not members of a wider world. It's just a closed little world really centered on Mexico City. And so what happens, and this actually happens in literature and a lot of other things too, what happens is you get a generation of young artists in the early 50s that they're led by this person, José Luis Cuevas, who decides that muralism has choked, infantilized, and basically stopped the development of Mexican art. And this is this great moment, 1953 specifically. People can point to a particular newspaper editorial article that this José Luis Cuevas wrote when he was 19 years old, called La Cortina del Nopal, which he called it the Nopal Curtain, the cactus curtain, where all cultural and visual things seem to stop at the U.S.-Mexico border because we've got this one idea of what art is. And God forbid that we should do anything else. And that's called the ruptura in Spanish. And in fact, it happens all over Latin America. It was so, the Mexico City was such a center, and this had so much resonance with other artists that all over Latin America, they call the early 50s la ruptura, which is when new modes of expression, sort of a lot of the stuff that Rivera was interested in the teens, comes back with a vengeance, and you have a whole wide range of artistic creativity, visual languages, like you see Cuevas' sculptures here. He's actually better known for his prints. Interestingly, he doesn't do paintings. He does a lot of prints so he can circulate them more widely. And Cuevas is also, because he comes out of this world which is heavily politicized and heavily charged with media, always like following Diego and Frida around and all of that, José Luis Cuevas is one of the first people who really then also decides, I have to manipulate the media, and he becomes this newspaper darling, and they get him to write editorials. He also writes beautifully, and he's incredibly smart. He writes editorials for every paper. He ends up, coming up with whole lines of products that have José Luis Cuevas, and this is well before Andy Warhol and what happens in the 60s in the United States. Cuevas is actually well before him a sort of pop culture icon, media person, and the proof of this is now there is an entire museum in central Mexico City dedicated to the work of José Luis Cuevas, in which not only do you see all his prints and all his stuff, but you can buy toilet paper by José Luis Cuevas, you can buy ashtrays, condoms. He's got lines of everything. I mean, large amounts of stuff that is José Luis Cuevas. And this is, a lot of people say to me, and Andy Warhol was very important as a pop culture, of course, icon in the United States in the 1960s and later, and without, you know, belaboring the comparison, actually, José Luis Cuevas did a lot of that much earlier. And I think it's because the art community in Mexico and in Latin America is so much more politicized and so much more media savvy already, that sort of thing then actually is developed later in Latin American art, right? But it wasn't always this way. It wasn't always modernism and then the revolt against, muralism and the revolt against muralism, which turns out to be the beginning of modern Latin American art. From 1953 on, then, really, Latin American art enters with a vengeance, enters the scene of worldwide contemporary art, and is still doing a great job of it. I don't know, has anybody been to see the Holly collection at the MFAH? I mean, you know, that's written about all over the world. It's collected all over the world. It's become just as important as German art or French art or whatever. And it's largely because of this ruptura. Cuevas is really seen as like somebody ushering in an entirely new discourse. But before we leave all this, and that really is one of my major points, that muralism has this incredible explosive effect in the 20s and ends up really shaking the foundations of American art in the 30s, but then becomes the monolithic thing that has to be broken for contemporary Latin American visual culture to sort of come into being. And so if you want the sort of sketch history, that's what happens. But I think it's really interesting to go back to the very beginning of the whole development of modern Latin American art, and that really is 1785, if we could get that little screen up here, right. 1785, and that's the founding of the first art academy in the Americas, period. North America, South America, Central America, anywhere. That's in Mexico City, the Academia de San Carlos, which, by the way, is still functioning. If you Google Academia de San Carlos, you will actually get their program of study. It's the National School of Art to this day. The oldest continuously functioning academy, the oldest academy in the Americas. Again, in 1785, there was not a single art school in New York or Boston. Chicago didn't even exist, you know, right? I mean, this is very, very old stuff. And what the academy does is it professionalizes and it secularizes art in Mexico. Before it's professionalized and secularized any place else in the Americas. And you have to remember that before 1785, all over the Americas, in Latin America more so than most, art was the handmaiden of religion, right? I mean, artists worked for the church. That was the major patron. If you wanted to make any money, you painted, you sculpted, you were the architect for the church. This happens to be at Colmon, which is one of the great 16th century conventos, churches in Mexico, but you could go on. Now, what the academia does is it introduces what we would think of as sort of capital Washington, D.C. kind of architecture, right? But this is before D.C. is built, right? It introduces neoclassical styles. It introduces the idea that art can express these great ideals of the state, that it can hook us back to the Greco-Roman democratic scientific ideals, etc. And it brings with it a very, very naturalistic, studied style that you see up here that has to do with grand history painting and grand heroic portraits of political figures. This, in fact, is a very important painting by a very important academic painter, José María Obregón. He's working in the later 19th century, but you could find examples like this all the way through of Latin American painters painting in this sort of pompous, big academic history style, but using it to investigate the specific history of Latin America. Because after all, this is the era of independence. Right after the academy is set up in 1785, you start having the wars for independence. You know, three decades later. And so you get almost immediately Latin American artists interrogating their own history. But they're doing it through this academic style, through the same style that the French interrogate their history. This is the same style that the United States is going to use with Washington crossing the Delaware, right, to sort of get their own visual mojo going. This is throughout Euro-American culture, you get what's called the academic style defining these new countries, these new histories. And so in that sense, Rivera's Palacio Nacional murals are just the latest step, much more popular, much more politically engaged on a very particular way, particular path. It's just one more step in that process that began really with the founding of the Academia de San Carlos. Now, everything that we've been talking about thus far has been about art, right, with the capital A, like stuff you see in museums, stuff you see in galleries, or stuff that you see on the walls of major public monuments. In the best case, you know, in the most sort of leftist radical case, it's the monuments. But a lot of the stuff we're talking about could be bought and sold and hung in private houses. What about this? Is this art? I mean, it certainly takes quite a bit of artistry, does it not? Indigenous weaving? It certainly takes a lot of skill, but it's not something that, until very recently, would never have shown up in any Latin American or North American museum. And I think that's important, that in fact, this is a big part of to this day. I mean, if you just talk about it, you can talk about it purely economically in dollars, you can talk about it in ideologically, like in the idea of what Latin Americans value and what North Americans value about Latin American culture. And this is important, this native arts, what's often called in anthropology tourist art, is actually incredibly important in Latin America economically and I think also sort of in the mind. You go to Oaxaca today and you go to a native village and you buy ceramics or you buy weavings, and that is, you're taking back something more authentic than a lot of stuff, than a lot of things that you could get, say, in Mexico City. Yes?
Do you think, I guess it's interesting that it seems these so-called tourist arts, which I guess I would call traditional or indigenous
traditional
forms of
indigenous art.
And in another class, I was studying the the discussion between primitivism and modernism.
Yes.
In the art in Italy and in the South, the subaltern classes, there was a rediscovery of their folk art. And I was wondering if you thought that was kind of in reaction to a growing globalization, like this reflection on the South as on southern Italy as very primitive, was in reaction to the rapid industrialization and concentration of wealth and factories in the north. And so it seems ironic that, well, maybe not ironic, but parallel that with this kind of increasing globalization and this idea of a global village, where we were talking the other day how you can go to the Zócalo in Oaxaca City and find tourist things imported from China that they're selling.
Yes, yes, absolutely.
And so do you think this recent recognized recognition of traditional art as maybe a valid art form is because that traditional lifestyle is so quickly disappearing?
Well, it's exactly like recording languages, which is another one of those things. I mean, we have all these people out recording languages because they're just going away. I mean, you can just see them. I mean, right now there are about 70 indigenous languages spoken in Mexico. In 30 years, maybe half that, right? But the and it's the same with these weaving communities and all of this. But there's revitalization. There may be, you know, who knows? Maybe there'll be more. I don't know. Maybe there'll be more bilingual indigenous people because of the way this works out in a globalizing economy. But let me go back to your initial analogy. In Sicily and southern Italy, these people who are left out of the modernization process suddenly discover a sort of folklore, become the primitive other. And they can sell that primitive other to these people who are newly wealthy, right? This is exactly what's happened in Mexico, exactly. Now, that is not to belittle the actual artistry and the actual tradition that is involved. These women are using, in fact, I know for a fact in the communities in which I worked in Guatemala, Choquiac-Cantel, which is really interesting in that particular thing, because what the Guatemalan government and capitalists did is they set up a huge textile mill right down the mountain from where I work. That is what Cantel is. It's a huge textile town. And then you have right up the mountain where I'm working all these women doing backstrap loom things and being paid an enormous amount of money, I mean, given the local economy, to do that if they can just get them out, if they can just find resources to get them to these people who are interested, right? And you have all sorts of different ways now to do that. But I think what's really important here, for an art historian, what's really important is whether you call it, I don't even like calling it tourist art, because that, in some ways, it belittles it. A lot of these people are actually, well, my point was, I know that these women who weave, for example, are actually, they learned from their mothers, who learned from their mothers, etc. This is not some sort of tradition they just invented last night. They're just finding different ways to distribute it. Right, so in tourist art has to me a little bit of this idea that, well, if you just scratch the surface, you're going to find, you know, Taiwanese goods, right? And that's true too. I mean, you go to Teotihuacan, to the archaeological site of Teotihuacan, and they're selling this crap just all over the place, you know, and it's just really obvious that people are gullible, and that why would you ever buy this stuff? It has nothing to do with anything except the guys running around selling it, right?
Well, and we also, in my Mexican immigration to the U.S. class, we were talking about how, I guess, Asia emerging as, well, in India and various places in Eastern Europe are emerging as competing powers, competing with Mexico and Latin America as producers, as mass producers, and that, I guess, that, you know, of cheap goods, and so it is cheaper for, in some cases, for Mexicans to import, you know, goods that are made in China, because they can't, you know, with all the industrialization and the displacement of people who used to rely on traditional livelihoods to moving to, you know, border towns, working in factories. Just interesting.
No, yeah, I think that's a huge pressure on the maquila system, right? And that's what's so interesting about, okay, let's use it, tourist art. say, because those communities who have created relationships with people who actually sort of see them do it, like the lady, you see the backstrap loom, you even have groups coming down from like Greenpeace or whatever and learning these things. If they get them involved in the actual process and in the humanity of the artists, then you have them hooked. I mean, there are certain villages in Oaxaca where it's got to come from that village in Oaxaca, and those people really have to do it. It can't look like it came from there. It can't be a Chinese knockoff of that. You have these sorts of direct relationships. When that happens, then indigenous villages usually do very well with so-called folk art. But I actually have a larger point, and because the interest, in the interest of time, I sort of want to, this is a great topic, but I have to make this point, and that is, if you just throw out the term art altogether, then all of this can kind of be mashed up into one big communicative sphere. And that's why I like to call it visual culture, because when you say visual culture, then you can put a weaving by a Maya woman together with a Diego Rivera mural, together with a little retablo, right, a little tin painting, an ex voto, and all of that is very important to the Mexican visual economy, both in terms of money and in terms of actually be circulating out there. And that way, if you don't call them art, you can just put them all together and sort of see how they relate, see how they interact. And not even to mention, because this is the great black hole of Mexican visual culture, not even to mention how pre-Columbian objects, looted and unlooted, circulate in the world art market. Believe me, that's a whole can of worms that we can't get into right now. That would be an entire class. So that's why I introduced this class with this idea of visual culture. Why even call it art? Because actually for the people of Mexico, this is all one big world now. And I just want one last sort of historical point that I think is really important. You know that how we sort of established that Mexican muralism was in many ways a conscious invention, if you will, of the Mexican government and a few artists sort of getting together and deciding we need a visual face. Well, believe it or not, and this needs to be talked about a lot more, actually indigenous art marketed to the larger world is also a direct historic, there's a moment where one of the great archaeologists, Alfonso Caso, who was at the time the director of INI, the Instituto Nacional Indigenista, decides that a way these people could make money, this is in the 30s, is market these wonderful, already, you know, the traditions are already there on the ground, but they could find other markets for them, and this would be a great help. It would be the entry into the cash economy for these people. And they just decided to do it. And until very recently, there was a whole system of stores run by INI that would introduce people to indigenous art. There was one on Avenida Hidalgo in Mexico City that was great. I miss that place. I love that place. That was like a boutique. It was beautifully done, boutique of all of these incredible craft traditions, tourist art, indigenous art, whatever you want to call it. It was like a storehouse of that place. And then you could read the label and get on a bus and go to that place, right? And that's how a lot of people did it. So I am all for visual culture as our moniker because it allows us to think of all these things as a relational whole. Now I promised to talk about themes, and I think that we can define some major themes. We might not have drawn the context as detailed a manner as we would have wished. But certainly, I mean, one of the themes are we modern? This is where native arts and muralism and the ruptura sort of come to a head. It's like Latin American artists are always asking, or did until recently ask, are we modern? Are we part of the greater globalized Euro-American intelligentsia? I think that's less of a question now, but if you look at it historically, it was a huge question. Or are we something else? Are we special in some way? Yes.
Can I ask you a quick question regarding that? I know there's been some debate about modern Latin American art. I read an article in which some historians debate it starts sort of in the period where North Americans define what modernism is.
Right.
You know, with Manet and so forth.
Right.
Or does it really start, like you were talking about, really when it's the reaction against the muralists, when you know, it's moving towards a whole different direction? Because, I mean, even throughout colonization and the independence, I mean, most of the art, like you were saying, was being produced under the standards of the academy. So really, they're not developing their own art. It's sort of coming from Europe. But it seems that in the 50s, like you were pointing out, especially with José Luis, is that it sort of shifts everything to a new modern art in Latin America. So what would your opinion be on that?
I would actually say, because I love deep history and I deal with a lot of ancient stuff, I would argue that the establishment of the Academia de San Carlos is really what sets the whole ball in motion. Because you can't have the rebellion against, you can't have what a lot of people call modern art unless you have academic art already set up. I mean, one of the huge problems with American art history, the history of the United States, is they get started so late, relatively, compared to Mexico, say, that they don't have a big academic tradition. I mean, you know, the art schools are founded literally 100 years later in North America than they are in Mexico. And so Mexico has this rich tradition of academic painting that, quite frankly, the United States is 50 to 75 years behind on. So you get that rich tradition of academic painting, and there really is something to push against. Then when they start sort of rebelling against it in the late 1800s, early 1900s. So I think it's the establishment of the academic tradition, profound establishment of the academic tradition, that gets everything going. And then you rebel against the sort of hermetic modernist stuff by inventing muralism. And then, of course, the social context is so important, as we pointed out. And then that becomes its own dogma, its own orthodoxy. And young, especially Mexican artists, say, it's el rechazo. You know, I can't deal with that anymore. And there's a lot, we're part of the global intelligentsia. That is one thing they're saying very strongly. We have just as much a right to manipulate the forms and values of art as any of our worldwide colleagues. And that's what the ruptura was really about. It was really about stating that, about we're global. Because they're global in the 50s, and they've never stopped being global. That's it. They've engaged themselves, established themselves as major players in the contemporary art scene. But I wouldn't call that the beginning of modernism. I think it's that break with the church that really starts everything going. But again, you know, it's like any historical period. It really depends on the viewer, right? What you want out of that definition. Wouldn't it be nice if we all woke up and said, you know, oh, it's January 1st, 1980. Oh, it must be postmodernism.
Right.
But we just don't do that.
Right.
Okay, if we are modern, is there a specifically Latin American modernity? That's a much more important question now. And I think much more interesting question for a lot of people. Are there things about our history, are there things about our current situation that make Latin American modernity different from French and German? I mean, you know, once you've sort of established yourself on the world stage, then it really becomes, you know, what do we want to do with modernity? What do we want to, how do we want that to? Yes.
Can I just break in with a question? Because you've really been problematizing what is art.
Right.
But we also should problematize, at least for a couple minutes, what is Latin American.
Oh, absolutely.
About art and or visual culture. When Mark Zimmerman spoke, he talked and talked about cultural studies and cultural theory and a little bit about literary criticism. He started by talking about those areas of inquiry as a kind of meta-thinking. In other words, asking how do we think about Latin America and not taking it for granted that we understand what it is. So I just raise that as, I think, an important, something important to think about on a variety of levels. What is Latin American art or visual culture? What is Mexican? Can Mexicans stand for Latin? I mean, stand for Latin American? There are a lot of questions embedded, I think, about identity in what you've been talking about.
Absolutely, and of course, in any context like this, I have simplified to the extreme. And I think the greatest thing to think about here is that I will fully admit, I guess one should admit one's bias, I'm much more engaged in the visual politics of Mexico than I am in any other place. But actually, if you're reading right now in contemporary theory, people write just as much and write just as interesting things about the contemporary art of Brazil, specifically. Argentina has always been a major player also. And there are all sorts of other different issues involved in what are clearly secondary art markets and art players. But Brazil and Argentina are just as important right now as Mexico, and in no way can be seen as equivalent for various reasons. I mean, Argentina has a completely different set of connections to Europe, is not at all as interested in this whole U.S. thing. Brazil speaks another language, you know, it views itself completely differently in relation to the entire world. I mean, and has a different art thing. I mean, you know, just to take a for instance, a very small for instance, there's a huge Japanese population or Sino-Brazil, I don't know how to say it, but the Brazilian Japanese in Sao Paulo, who happen to sort of specialize in making great contemporary art. I mean, there's just a huge art community in Sao Paulo who all have Japanese last names. And this is a whole school of art that, of course, has nothing to do with Mexico or Argentina or anything, but is incredibly important in Brazil. And I mean, you know, I'm talking about economy. I saw a major retrospective of these guys in Rio de Janeiro, and it just blew me away. I mean, this is some of the greatest abstract art of the last half of the 20th century. And yet, you know, you couldn't invent them. I mean, who would even think that this is, and that's just a small for instance. But again, yeah, you just can't make this equivalent. And we have been speaking very much in Mexico-centric terms. I mean, that's just the way we've been doing it. And what makes it really difficult too is, I actually studied under the first person to try to put together a textbook on 20th century Latin American art. And it's just painful to read it in the sense that, you know, she knew so much about all of this stuff, and yet trying to find that one defining narrative, that thread that we want to have in a textbook or a sort of story like that, I mean, in the end, there is none. You know, it's too varied. The variations are, in some ways, what's really interesting. Yes?
Do you think that it might be so hard to find, I guess, a uniting theme or a common expression for all Latin American art? Because I guess it seems to me that the art that comes out of Latin America in general, and just with a few examples that you've given, is very politicized art, like you said. And so because each country has struggled with different revolutions and different government problems and just different cases of political struggle, manifested itself differently in different countries.
Yeah, absolutely. I think that one shouldn't reduce it to those differences in this sense. Again, a very simple example. Brazilians, in their, if you look at the manifestos of art, if you look at the way they talk about their art, they talk about it in a very different way than do the Mexicans, say. They don't feel the same sorts of political tugs and pulls. They have different political pulls and tugs. They are much more insistent, for example, on the way Africa and the Americas has come together. I mean, just as a matter of cultural history. There are all these differences that are really, really, really important. Yes. And the struggles with, say, military power in the 50s and 60s, which runs through Latin American art of that period, is not the same. You know, it's not, you can't look at all of it and say, oh, that's all military struggles. I mean, they look at it and express it in very different ways. So, you know, okay, so if yes, is there a specifically Latin American modernity? I think that given our discussion, one would probably have to say no, unless you're talking about the most gross, you know, the most sort of rough estimates. And there are those, though. I mean, people did go through a lot of military junta dictatorship and the reaction to it, for example. People did go through, almost everyone went through a muralist phase. Almost every Latin American country went through a muralist phase in the late 20s and early 30s. But of course, how they how they then reacted to that, how they reacted to sort of the fall, if you will, of muralism, completely different in the different areas, that sort of thing. So if no, where are our visual roots? You know, what is indigenous, for example? I mean, Argentina simply doesn't care much about what is indigenous because that's not a major part of their history. Mexico is obsessed with this idea, right? So you get very different answers even to that. And finally, what I would like to do is, because I don't want to go away without giving you some sort of hat rack that you can hang all that stuff onto, is that I want to just, I think, give you the key dates here. And again, we sort of discussed this already. I would say the establishment of the academy and the separation of art and church was extremely important. And then one has to see then the rise of muralism is a very, although we've sort of talked against it to some extent in this class, it's crucial, it's key, and there's no, I mean, it would be silly to deny that. But the splintering of muralism was also very, very important. That eventually leads to then this full-blown rupture with the ideals, the style, that the entire world, artistic world that muralism had constructed. And all of this is happening in a backdrop that where you have an enormous amount of other things going on in visual culture. And I mean, today we'd also have to do in the enormous media machines that are housed in Sao Paulo, Caracas, and specifically Mexico City. And this is part of the, this is a really important part of the Latin American visual scene. I find it very interesting that the TV stations are now some of the biggest collectors of contemporary art. They all know that this is one big sort of pool of ideas and images that circulates. TV Azteca is an enormous contemporary art collection, for example. We have very little time, I'm afraid, for anything else. I've really enjoyed your questions. I don't know if you have to record that, but I have. I've really enjoyed your questions.
Okay, we are back, and we have been chatting about Frida Kahlo and women in art. And since I'm not an art historian, I don't really want to say too much on tape or for posterity about women artists. But I think it is interesting to think about people like Frida Kahlo and what their connection is or was to the art scene of a certain time and place, and why it is at certain times we do get interested in people like Frida Kahlo. What I do want to do in this part of class today is to talk about gender and get back to the whole topic of Indigenous women and Indigenous women's roles, their role in history. I want to particularly focus on the history of Indigenous or Native women in the 20th century. But like Frida Kahlo, there is a particular Indigenous woman whose name is very well known, who I will mention briefly later. Her name is Rigoberta Menchu. And I am interested in this whole issue of, in relationship to women's history and gender roles, I am interested in this whole question of iconic women, who they are and why they become iconic. Why do they become such important symbols carrying all sorts of weight? So when we talk about women in the colonial period, everybody starts with Malintzin, whom we talked about earlier in the semester. When we talk about women artists, everybody talks about Frida Kahlo. When we talk about Indigenous women, especially women as activists, and that's a whole subject that I will get to today, everybody talks about Rigoberta Menchu. And these women are iconic. They are in and of themselves very important. But I will argue about each of the women that I've just mentioned that in part they're important because their own lives were deeply fascinating for all sorts of public and private reasons. But also they're iconic because they are symbolic of larger shifts and changes. Sometimes they bring those changes about themselves. Sometimes social or historical changes make them more important, and then we recognize their importance. But in focusing on those particular women, and Frida Kahlo helps us think about Professor Kuntz's very, very insightful lecture about visual culture, that gets us back to the whole theme of culture, which has been important in the second part of our course, that is in the second part of the semester. And the concept of culture has been used in a whole variety of ways by Professor Zimmerman talking about cultural studies, by Professor Chestnut talking about religion and culture, by Professor Hernandez talking about culture and stories, the stories that people tell themselves and others about their cultures and history in order to understand their own identity. Art can also be seen both as a kind of culture and as a part of a larger culture, as Professor Kuntz talked about. And gender roles, obviously, are also a very important part of culture and history. And that's the topic that I want to pick up with. I had started to talk about Indigenous women and their history, I think about 2 weeks ago. But I had not been able to fully talk about the topic, and I really do have a lot more to say about it. And that's what I would like to talk about during my part of class today. And I want for us to be thinking about Native women in the 20th and 21st centuries. I had mentioned a number of themes as I began to talk about that, so let me get back to this issue of themes and issues that I think are important in terms of understanding women's history and women's roles. I think there are a number of points that are important to recognize. One has to do with the ways that indigenous women filled institutionalized economic and political roles in order to carry out tasks of production and reproduction. These roles can carry authority. They have in the past, they do in the present. And they can also express women's agency. Remember, we talked about this concept of agency, how people act in the world, how they act in order to ensure their own survival on a daily basis, and sometimes how they act more dramatically to create change. Resistance, rebellion, revolution, these have also been themes that we've talked about this semester, and women have played a role in those kinds of activities. And that's something else that I think is important to chronicle in terms of women's history. And what's been interesting about indigenous women is that in many times and places, they have been active in political and social conflicts and in activities of resistance, and they have done so. They have been active agents, even though gender dynamics, kinship and household structures, and patterns of land ownership often have acted to limit women's range of action within indigenous communities. And that's been another whole important issue for women to deal with in the past and in the present. That is that the patriarchal political structure of nation states, which I think is a carryover from both colonial political and legal structures, as well as the liberal nation-building agenda of the 19th century in Latin America. But these patriarchal political structures, reinforced by certain kinds of political and economic changes of the 20th century, also reinforced gender roles and dynamics in indigenous communities. And so that's been something that women have had to deal with. In the research that I've done on the history of indigenous women, which is one of the areas that I've concentrated on in terms of my own research while I've been at the university, in my research, I've examined gender roles and women's lives in many different groups across Latin America. And I'll quickly go through a list of groups that I've worked on and that I will talk about today in surveying indigenous women's history and roles. First, I've looked at indigenous women in different parts of Mesoamerica, and I will talk about Nahua women being the descendants of the Aztecs. I'm going to talk about women among the Zapotecs. The Zapotecs, as I'll mention, are found in the contemporary state of Oaxaca in Mexico. And the Zapotecs often referred to themselves, especially in the past, as the Nudzawi. But the term Zapotec is often commonly used and is commonly used today. I'll also talk about women among the Maya. Rigoberta Menchú, whom I have briefly mentioned, is a Maya woman from Guatemala, and she has had an interesting and important life. I'll just mention now that she was the 1992, and the year 1992 is very important in this context. She was the 1992 Nobel Peace Prize winner. And if you think about why the year 1992 might be important in relation to Rigoberta Menchú, remember that 1992 was the quincentennial or 500th year quote unquote anniversary, because not everybody saw it as a celebration, but 1992 was the 500th year anniversary of Columbus coming to the New World. So 1992 had that was a year with lots of significance. I've also looked at the history of indigenous women in South America. And here it's important to draw a distinction, as I will, between Highland South America in the western part of South America, the highlands running along the western side of the Andes Mountains, from the western side of the Andes Mountains to the western coast. And there are a number of groups that I've looked at there, and I'll get into that in more detail. Then I've looked at women of the tropical lowlands, and I'll talk about that. And women of the tropical lowlands span, and their culture span, a number of countries and regions, and their cultures are quite different from the highland cultures of South America. Then there are indigenous women of Central America, and we had been talking two classes ago about Central America. Here I will talk in particular about three groups and gender roles among those three groups: the Garifunas, the Miskitos, and the Kunas. And if I'm lucky enough to get through all that today, then I will come back again to the question of what common themes can we draw about, and conclusions can we draw about women's roles across these very broad areas, which geographically and culturally are very, very different. And I'll also try to spend a little bit of time talking about the future. Given a fairly detailed understanding of women's roles in 20th century Native cultures, what might that understanding allow us to predict about Native women's roles in the future? And before I get into some of the specifics and begin to look at specific groups, I do want to talk about, briefly, about this term indigenous. In Latin America, Native people are often referred to, of course, as Indios or Indians, but in Latin America, the term Indio often has a very negative connotation in a very racially and ethnically stratified world. The term Indio is often used by non-Indians or non-Indios, to use a sort of hybrid term. It's often used by non-Indios in a way that is not, it's not neutral. It carries very negative implications, not just about poverty, but about the negative cultural characteristics of groups, what we in North America might refer to as Indian groups or Indian tribes. The term can be used in a very negative or pejorative way about both people and groups. And therefore, in my own writing, I tend to stay away from it. And I tend to use the words either Native or Indigenous, Indigenous being a word that is often used in Latin America, though many times when quote-unquote indigenous people refer to themselves, they often refer to themselves by terms that refer to the name of their community, occasionally the name of the ethnicity, though that depends on the area, because it's only very, very recently, for example, that the Maya have a sense of themselves as Mayas per se. And I could talk at much greater length about the history and nature of ethnicity, but I don't really want to take up a whole lot of time about that now. But I guess what I'd like to emphasize is this idea that the term Indian or Indio is not a positive one, therefore I've tended to stay away from it. And actually, I kind of like the term that's used in Canada, which is the term First Peoples, or First People, is usually used in Canada to refer to what we might call Native Americans or Indigenous people. I like that term. I think it's actually, in a lot of ways, the most accurate term, but it's not used in Latin America, so I won't impose it. As I talk about groups of people today. Also, I do just want to point out that I think it is important to be conscious of how people think about themselves. How do they name themselves? Because that helps us understand something about how they understand themselves. But also, I think as outsiders to their communities or ethnicities, it's very important that we ask them, well, what do you want to be called? Because when we're talking to them or reading about them or learning about them, I do think we need to remember that their culture doesn't exist simply for us to consume as something interesting, but it exists because they live it every day. And we need to remember that and be respectful of it. Coming back to the issue of Indigenous women, which is what I really want to focus on today, I am going to look at this by region. And I've given you a little bit of a sense of the regions. And I do want to start with Nahua women. Nahua women are the descendants of the group that you would know as the Aztecs. They live in central Mexico. They are spread, Nahuas are spread over a very large area of central Mexico today. And these are the people that in my own work I know the most about. And so I'll talk about Nahua women at the greatest length and then use some of the ideas, issues, and concepts that I've already mentioned and that I will use as I talk about Nahua women. I will use some of these ideas and concepts as a way to talk about the other groups that I've mentioned. So, Nahua women are the descendants of the group, as I've just said, that you would know as the Aztecs. Nahuas are spread over a very large part of central Mexico, from the northern state of San Luis Potosí, in the northeastern part of the nation of Mexico. Nahuas are also found in the central states of Hidalgo, the state of Mexico, as opposed to the city of Mexico or the Distrito Federal. They are also found in the state of Puebla, the state of Tlaxcala, and then to the west in the states of Guerrero and Morelos, as well as Veracruz to the south and east. So Nahua people or Nahuat-speaking peoples, and not all the communities that might be classified as Nahua today have many people left in them still speaking Nahua. That's a whole other question. But Nahua communities span a very large area, and because of that, it's no surprise, I think, that local communities, local economies, and women's roles within these communities and economies do vary. Nonetheless, anthropologists, when they wrote about Nahua peoples in the 20th century, when anthropologist ethnographers, and actually ethnography is another term I should put up here as a concept that's been mentioned. And ethnography is an intensive study of a particular group at a particular point in time. I write history, so I tend to look at groups and people over time. Professor Hernandez writes anthropological ethnography, so she looks at groups, people, and places at a particular point in time. And her research is all based on her interaction with those people. Some of mine is, but most of mine is based on reading documents. And that's a difference. One of the things I did in trying to look at the history of women is use ethnographies as historical documents. And so I'll talk a little bit about that. When ethnographers of the Nawas wrote about women in the 20th century, they often wrote about them as if they didn't do anything more than live in their houses, and essentially they were the Nawa version of 1950s housewives. And a very well-known ethnographer of Mexico, Robert Redfield, in 1930 captured this idea very nicely when he wrote, and here I quote, "While he, Nawa male, is led by the cycle of the sun, she, the female, is the servant of another cycle, that of hunger and its satisfaction." And I think that's a very nice way of talking about being a housewife. And it's especially talking about being a housewife who is really concerned about food and cooking. Other ethnographers, from Oscar Lewis on, who wrote in the 1950s and 60s and wrote a very important series of ethnographies about both Nawas and then about working class people in Mexico City. Other ethnographers from Oscar Lewis on found that Nawa women's work has not only been household-based during the 20th century, but that it has also varied regionally and changed over time. So what kinds of work have women done besides the work that they've done in the home? They have worked as domestic servants. They have worked at selling in local or regional markets, meaning outdoor markets. They've done storekeeping in small shops. They've worked in textile factories. We think of maquilas as a late 20th century development on the Mexican-U.S. border, but in fact, factories to produce cloth and or assemble textiles of various sorts have existed in Latin America from the 19th century on, and some of those factories were put in rural areas, not in urban areas. And Nawa women were among the first textile workers in textile factories in Tlaxcala, in the state of Tlaxcala in Mexico, in the 19th century. Nawa women have also provided paid labor for agriculture. They've also worked in health-related tasks such as being midwives, curers, and performing as ritual specialists. Economic change across Mexico and in many parts of the central region has had an impact on women's labor. The introduction of textile factories in the 19th century. In some places, those factories employed women, as I mentioned. In some places, those factories tended more to employ men. But what that then did is it left women to take up the slack in terms of work in communities and homes. And so there were all sorts of ways in which modernizing economic change, because we just finished hearing about modernism as a trend in art, but modernization is also an important trend in political and economic history. Modernization, the coming of factories, for example, no matter whether factories employed men or women, that employment had implications for the other gender. Another economic change of significance for Nahua women dates to the 1920s, when commercial corn mills were established. And commercial corn mills were very important, because commercial corn mills meant that individual women no longer had to spend time every day grinding corn for tortillas. Oscar Lewis, who I already mentioned, another very important ethnographer, wrote about the importance of corn mills, and I will quote, "The mills have been great time savers. Previously, women spent from 4 to 6 hours a day grinding corn, often getting up at 4 in the morning to prepare tortillas for their husbands. Now women get more sleep, usually rising at 6. The time saved is used in various ways, such as sewing, knitting, going to church more often, and doing household chores. The added leisure has in many cases been turned towards gainful pursuits, such as raising chickens, pigs, and cows. Furthermore, many women became merchants on a small scale and regularly go to Cuernavaca or other cities to sell corn, bean, eggs, etc. The improved communication offered by the road and bus lines made this possible. Men assert that there has been an increase in adultery because of the fact that so many young married women go to Cuernavaca or other cities alone. Indeed, the husbands of these women are called tonto, or fools, for permitting their wives such liberties." There are a number of interesting aspects of that passage from Oscar Lewis's writing in terms of some of the assumptions he makes, but in terms of some of the observations he makes about gender roles embedded just in this brief passage about the impact of corn mills. More recent changes have also had a great impact. On the Gulf Coast, for example, where oil was found and where cattle economies, that is, ranching economies, have become more important in the second half of the 20th century, a whole series of changes have taken place. These include land loss, in some cases out-migration, as land has moved from communities to large landed estates, and increasing amounts of capital, whatever capital comes to exist in indigenous communities, has increasingly been concentrated in male hands. And that has tended to undermine Nahua women's access in this region. It's undermined their access to and control of land and wages. These patterns cause women to become more dependent on men for their economic survival. And the issue of access to land has also undermined the economic well-being of women. In most Nahua regions, sons traditionally inherited more property than daughters, but on the Gulf Coast, the spread of larger scale cattle ranching has undermined many men's and women's, especially women's, access to land. So what you have happening in Nahua communities is the emergence of a more rigid class structure, greater differentiation among families in terms of their access to wealth and where greater amounts of wealth have come into these communities, men have tended to control it. And that, of course, has lots of implications. In terms of politics and Nahua women's political activities, it is important to examine the context in which women can hold power, starting with the family and household. While the nuclear family is the most common residential and economic unit, the three-generation unit of grandparents, married children, and their children remains an important social unit even today. Patrilocal marriage, which is a marriage pattern in which a young bride moves in with or near her husband's family and provides labor for the family under the direction typically of her mother-in-law, helps reinforce this structure. This marriage pattern means that young brides typically endure a difficult period of adjustment during which they hold a position of extreme submission to their husbands, to their fathers-in-law, and to their mothers-in-law. By all reports, it's not fun. Age, however, brings changes in women's status in the household. A general pattern of female submissiveness does not preclude high levels of conflict between spouses, As Oscar Lewis noted in 1951, quote, according to the ideal culture patterns for husband-wife relations in the community he was studying, which was named Tepoztlan, the husband is an authoritarian patriarchal figure who is head and master of the household and enjoys the highest status in the family. But Lewis also observed that the dominant husband-submissive wife pair is, to some extent, a quote-unquote social fiction. While the new wife faces a difficult period of adjustment because she's left the security of her own home and needs to please demanding in-laws and a demanding husband, she will most likely someday herself become a mother-in-law as she moves through the life cycle, one who enjoys authority over her children, daughters-in-law, sometimes even over her own husband. Recent ethnography suggests also that the pattern of marriage is changing. Patrilocal marriage certainly still exists, but married children are forming their own household sooner, which is then removing a younger married couple from that context of authority more quickly. And some women are making their own choices to separate from their husbands and to either live with their own families of birth or to live on their own or not to marry at all, yet to still have children. But I should also point out that apart from the kinds of authority that a woman can almost naturally grow into through the course of the life cycle, Nahua women also take on more publicly recognized authority roles. These include roles such as midwives, curers, marriage intermediaries, or participating in the civil religious hierarchy common to many parts of Mexico and Mesoamerica, known in the Nahua-speaking region as the cargo system. And what the cargo system really is a political and authority structure within communities in which men, usually along with their wives, hold a series of hierarchically arranged positions, moving from more lowly positions to positions of much more authority. And men cycle through these, the holders of these positions often change on a yearly basis, and women can accrue some authority in that system depending on who their husbands are. So Nahua women do have arenas in which they can assert authority and power. Their actions in asserting authority and power can be both complementary to, yet they often are still subordinate to the authority and power of men. Primarily because Nahua family and kinship configurations tend to undermine female agency more than they promote it. The patrilocal marriage pattern that I already mentioned plays a prominent role in weakening female assertions of will, but there are two other important factors that also undermine women's authority. That is their age at marriage and violence against women. One important factor in understanding women's authority is that women, past and present, sometimes marry very young, sometimes as early as in their early teens. And no 13 or 14-year-old in any world culture that I'm aware of in 2007, because we're not talking about the Stone Age when people were lucky if they lived to be the age of 40. No 13-year-old in any contemporary context that I'm aware of, no 13-year-old woman, girl, whatever term we want to use, has very much authority. And it's not just that they're marrying at age 13, 14, 15, but they're marrying boys or men who are older. They're not marrying 13-year-old boys, because I wouldn't claim that a 13-year-old boy is a great has a great fount of authority either. But that's not who they're marrying. They're marrying boys or men who are either somewhat or sometimes much older. There's an incredible authority balance imbalance right there. Another important factor in terms of women's authority is that domestic violence occurs. It can be used by men to express dissatisfaction over performance of household tasks. Sometimes it takes place when wives challenge their husband's authority. Sometimes domestic violence takes place when wives express jealousy over possible attractions on the part of their husbands to other women. I don't want to assert that no violence takes place between women and men that isn't male on female. In other words, and let me say that in a less convoluted way, when domestic violence takes place, yes, sometimes it can start with women. Sometimes in a context of a violent incident, women can hit or lash out or even injure men if they have a weapon. But the most common, by far most common, scenario for domestic violence is male on female. And given age and physical differences, the consequences of domestic violence for women in indigenous cultures in Mesoamerica, and I would argue across Latin America, and there are colonial roots for this, and colonial roots for patterns of domestic violence in Latin American cultures more broadly. Because of age and physical differences between men and women, the consequences of domestic violence for women are more serious, and it is a real problem. One other caveat before I go on, and there is a question which I'll get in a second. I don't want to say or be heard to say that domestic violence is more prevalent or is worse in Native communities than in non-Native communities, because that's not the case. I also don't want to be heard to say that domestic violence is a worse problem in Latin America than in other parts of the world. I'm asserting none of those things. I am simply talking about the patterns of domestic violence as they have been observed and written about by ethnographers, by Latin Americans, by insiders, sometimes to these communities. And there was a question.
I was wondering if earlier you said age of marriage and violence against women undermine the power and authority of women. Against women, do you mean specifically?
In this context, I am specifically talking about domestic violence, though there are other kinds of violence against women as well, which have to do with politics and political situations and political conflicts, and I'm hoping that I'm going to have time to comment a little bit on that broader context. But in general, today when I talk about violence against women, I'm talking about domestic violence. Nonetheless, even with factors that do have a negative impact on women's authority, not all women do find ways to play political roles and enact agency beyond the household. Because the political religious system of leadership that I mentioned needs female labor to function, women's roles within that system, complementary to and necessary for husbands in order for them to carry out their own positions. Women's roles influence whether men hold offices, and when they do, how they carry out their appointed tasks. Thus, women can influence whether and how successfully men can climb the ladder of positions that make up a hierarchical leadership system or structure. Nonetheless, in the political system as constructed by the post-revolutionary Mexican state, the constitutional councils of local communities are made up of and headed by men. One of the interesting things about councils within indigenous communities is that women in Mexico got the right to vote in 1953. But even today, when we look at elections at the local level, women vote at the local level in peasant communities and indigenous communities, but especially in indigenous communities, women tend to vote at much lower levels, in many smaller numbers. And they participate in local political meetings at far lower rates. So there are a variety of contradictory practices at work here that we need to try to understand in assessing something about the status of women. Women began to find means to protest some of these exclusionary practices beginning in the 1930s. Women, for example, some Nahua women, for example, began to protest their lack of access to communal lands. These were lands that were being distributed as a result of the Mexican Revolution. These lands are known as ejidos, and women began to protest their lack of access to ejido lands. Women from the 1930s on also began to participate in some meetings, regional or national, meetings among women to discuss issues that were and are of the greatest importance to them, including work conditions, male outmigration, alcoholism, and other health problems suffered by both men and women. Nahua women have also tried to form co-ops to market their crafts and to use those co-ops as a structure to promote discussion of women's and larger community issues. In one indigenous community in northeastern Mexico, for example, women who got fed up with high rates of male consumption of alcohol forced the closure of illegal alcohol factories and publicly burned hidden supplies. And a woman who was interviewed about this protest said, quote, "A lot of men are not happy with this, with what they did. But, oh well, at least now they spend time with their families. So in the end, things are better." The development of women's co-ops or grassroots movements to promote gender equality has not occurred among Nahuas and in Nahua areas to the same extent as it has elsewhere, especially in Maya regions. And it's a really interesting question, which I'll try to get to, about why co-ops have tended to work better in certain areas than in others. For Nahuas, it may be that their communities are so dispersed and they are found under such geographically and culturally different conditions, and their communities have experienced such intense waves of change that forming communal organizations of any type becomes very difficult. Another important facet of change for Nahua women and indigenous women of Central Mexico more generally, which I haven't mentioned yet, has to do with the migration of indigenous women themselves to urban areas, especially Mexico City. And a stream of female migration began to become common in the second half of the 20th century. Why did this come about? It came about largely as a result, paradoxically enough, of male outmigration. Men from Nahua communities were migrating either over shorter distances or longer distances, for shorter amounts of time or longer amounts of time. And as that male outmigration increased, this left an increasing number of women who were single or married who had to fend for themselves and for their children. Population pressure and shortages of arable or usable land also worsened women's lives and contributed to a kind of feminization of indigenous poverty that resulted in a form of what might be called super exploitation of women who were and are desperate to help themselves and their children and families by performing a variety of kinds of work for extremely low wages. And the search for any kind of work then often drew women into cities, especially Mexico City. If you've been in any of the tourist areas of Mexico City, you may be familiar with what is a virtual army of impoverished, displaced, single, married, or widowed indigenous women who are known in Mexico as the Marias. They can be found on many streets, most especially in the tourist areas of Mexico City and other urban areas. Many of them are Nahuas, others are from different central area groups, but they and their children who often accompany them sell fruits or vegetables, gum, and or crafts such as dolls in or near city markets, historical centers, and other tourist areas. They are not cheerful or folkloric figures. These are women who live in extreme poverty, who live in extreme circumstances, who may themselves suffer from the effects of domestic violence, other kinds of urban violence, the impact of alcoholism or mental illness, either their own or of family members. They live really hard lives. And they live hard lives due to a series of systemic factors that we can understand as historical pressures that have led to women making decisions in which they find themselves in these circumstances. Because Nahua and other Central Mexican indigenous groups are exposed to a very great degree of integration into the market economy of the contemporary nation state of Mexico, and because they are widely dispersed over a large landscape, the material factors that drive economic and cultural change perhaps impede the construction or reconstruction of a pan-Nahua identity. The construction of a pan-Maya identity is something that has happened to a much greater extent than it has in central Mexico. And for Mayas, that's true in both southern Mexico and in Guatemala itself. Thus, material factors that drive economic and cultural change loom very large in understanding how women's lives, work patterns, political participation, and family lives have changed. Thus, Nahua women have often experienced a greater degree of exposure to the dominant mestizo society. That tends to lead to language loss, can lead to pretty dramatic and rapid cultural change. And it's also meant that Nahua women, whether they're in their own home communities or elsewhere, have often experienced a lack of access to education. And that lack of access to education has hampered their efforts to better their own and their families' lives. In other parts of Mesoamerica, we find a somewhat different picture. And I will go on and talk now about Zapotec women. Zapotec or Nuzawi groups are found in the southern and eastern parts of the modern state of Oaxaca. These groups are well known through the art and writing of a number of Mexican and foreign artists and writers who were very interested in the Zapotecs. And they were particularly interested in Zapotec women, who were often portrayed as having an exotic image. An image that was captured best in a quote from the Mexican artist and writer Miguel Covarrubias, in which he described the Tehuanas or the Zapotec women of the Isthmus of Tehuantepec in the following way. Covarrubias wrote that each Tehuana was, quote, a queen, a composite image of Egypt, Crete, Indian, and a gypsy camp. Zapotec poets never tire of writing in praise of the flowing lines, the stride, and the carriage of their women. Tehuanas were also the subject of a famous 1973 feminist ethnography by an anthropologist named Beverly Chenius. Chenius wrote a book called The Isthmus Zapotecs, Women's Roles in Cultural Context. Sometimes Zapotec women were and are described as matriarchal figures. That is, these were seen as women who really had power, more power than men and power over men. I would say that's a tremendous overstatement. A careful reading of the 20th century ethnographic literature shows that while Zapotec women have played an important role in the region's economic system as both local and longer distance merchants, and that's one of the interesting things about them, that they've done a variety of kinds of work, many of which are similar to the kinds of work that I mentioned for Nahua women, but Zapotec women have often specialized in trading and working as merchants. They've also played an important role in the political religious hierarchy of that region. But their lives have often been marked by poverty, by domestic violence, by social unrest, and by male dominant ideology and political structures. Formal political roles and offices have tended in this area as well to remain in male hands. Women are also disadvantaged by the young ages at which they marry. And their image of strength and activism often gets used by Zapotec political organizations more as a way of symbolizing Zapotec identity than as an accurate characterization of women's political roles and authority. And I think that's one of the paradoxes of Zapotec culture and why it's important to know about and to compare to some of the cultures and gender roles, some of the other cultures and gender roles of Mesoamerica, is that Zapotec women have this exotic image, have often been used as important symbols of the ethnic identity, but that hasn't exactly translated into meaningful power on a daily basis. We come also to the story and the position of Maya women. The Maya as a group are very complex. The Maya are the largest single native group in Mesoamerica. They are probably not the single largest indigenous group in Latin America, because it might be that the highland peoples of South America who speak one of two languages, either Quechua or Aymara, might be that those peoples as a whole who are culturally fairly uniform, or it might be that the highland peoples are larger in number, but except for the highland South American groups, the Maya are the single largest indigenous group, certainly in Mesoamerica, and loom large in terms of indigenous groups across Latin America more generally. Maya groups are found in Mexico, Guatemala, and Belize. They number in the millions. I've seen estimates that range from about 4 million to about 12 million. There isn't an exact estimate that I could give you that I really have a lot of confidence in. They do, however, number in the millions. They are linguistically and culturally differentiated. That is, within the Maya, there are a variety of linguistic and cultural variations of importance. And anthropologists have, for better or worse, found their ancient and contemporary cultures to be of great interest. No group among Latin American indigenous people has attracted more interest than the Maya, prehistoric, historical, modern, and contemporary. Like with Nahua women, earlier anthropologists tended to stress the housebound nature of Maya women's lives, whether they were talking about Maya women in the Yucatan, Maya women in the Chiapas Highlands, or Maya women of Guatemala. But like Nahua women, they played a variety of economic roles within and beyond the household. Unlike Nahua women, Maya women tended to produce more goods when they were engaging in productive work that had implications beyond the household. They were often producing goods that had market value. They were producing goods that many anthropologists would refer to as crafts. I tend not to like that word, though it has some utility, because I think it both romanticizes and belittles the making of, for example, textiles and doing weaving. It isn't just a quaint traditional practice that makes beautiful things that we might like to look at. Weaving and textiles had real utilitarian meaning. But unlike the Zapotec women that I mentioned, they engaged very little in trade, especially longer distance trade. They might sell in markets, but these would be local markets at best. As elsewhere, the globalization of the economy and the greater tendency of men to migrate has intensified women's labor within and beyond the household. Women began, especially in the second half of the 20th century, Maya women began to perform more agricultural labor, produce crafts for local markets, and sell their labor, often working as domestics or agricultural workers. And today, some are also migrating to perform such labor as far as in to parts of the U.S. and even Canada. One of the ways that Maya women sought to increase their economic power was to form cooperatives. And the cooperatives among Maya women haven't been necessarily uniformly successful, but they've been more successful than they were or have been among Nahua women. Co-ops help women buy supplies at lower cost, and they help women sell what they produce to a wider market. In terms of family and kinship structures, these are fairly similar to the kinds of structures that I described for the Nahuas, so I won't go into that in detail. Again, we have similar patterns of both assertion of authority, yet factors within and beyond the culture that undermine that authority. In Maya culture, age is very important. It's important in Nahua culture, but it's even more important in Maya culture. And deference to authority, older, younger, male, female, those patterns of deference are very important, and they don't empower women. Another thing that's important to point out is that Maya women have, in particular, experienced some very extreme kinds of violence. That have really influenced everybody in Maya communities in southern Mexico and in Guatemala. In southern Mexico, we have the emergence of the EZLN, that is the Zapatistas, in the 1990s. And this led to an engagement, often armed and very tense, between the Mexican army and the Zapatistas. And this also led to lots of conflict within Maya communities, as some people sided with the PRI, others sided with the Zapatistas. Compounding that conflict within indigenous communities in southern Mexico, especially in Chiapas, has been the Protestant Catholic split that Professor Chestnut spoke about. In Chiapas, the conflict between traditionalist Catholics and converts to Protestantism and evangelical religion has been so extreme that it's led to outright violence. And women get caught up in these political issues and issues of religious and cultural change, of course. And in the case of political violence, women have felt that violence in terms of rape and other kinds of violence towards women that has accompanied the presence of the Mexican army. And also in this area, because of the political conflict, paramilitary groups have emerged as well, and violence against women has occurred in that context as well. In Guatemala, as I talked about earlier, a couple of weeks ago, Guatemala experienced extreme political violence, and this was really violence between the left and the right, but indigenous communities got caught up in that violence to such an extent that it became a civil war. Because indigenous communities were often assumed to be or suspected of being aligned with leftist groups, and that brought down a lot of intense violence to such an extent that whole communities were wiped out in the most heated period of violence between 1975 and 1985. What is particularly significant in terms of what happened in Guatemala is that the political violence that took place against indigenous communities in Guatemala affected both men. It affected men, women, and children. Many men were targeted, and of course, many more men than women were killed. But women experienced the kinds of political violence that I've mentioned, and many women were killed as well. But there were two consequences of that period of violence for women that are particularly interesting. One is that women became widowed. Women in indigenous communities became widowed in far greater numbers and at far higher rates than they had earlier. It's important to understand that in many rural parts of Latin America, where poverty is often extreme, that the pattern that we are familiar with women outliving men is reversed. And there are a whole variety of reasons for that I could go into. Some of it has to do with malnutrition, some of it has to do with the different disease and injury patterns that men and women suffer. Some of it has to do with childbirth and dying in childbirth. At any rate, my point is that in many cases, in rural communities in Guatemala, as a result of the political violence, women were widowed in far higher numbers than they had been previously. And there were many communities in which a large number of the adults present in the community were widowed women. These were women who had not previously held positions of power. They were extremely poor, because in these families, in rural areas, both men and women need to work for families to survive. They were in communities that were traumatized by violence. They themselves were often traumatized by violence, because if they hadn't themselves experienced violence, family members often had. And you had whole communities that were becoming, in a sense, communities of traumatized women who were having to survive in the post-Civil War world. In traditional Maya communities that had political and religious structures that were dependent on the presence and activities of men. So all of a sudden you have patriarchal systems that don't have enough patriarchs. And that's a problem. In part as a result of that, but for other reasons as well, and feminism and the spread of feminism is not unrelated to this, you begin to have indigenous women becoming more politically active. In part as a kind of self-help. For themselves and women in their communities. And in part as a response to changing and globalizing political systems. Rigoberta Menchú was a K'iche' Maya woman, is a K'iche' Maya woman, born in 1959, who in her teens and 20s began to become a political activist in Guatemala. She is perhaps most famous for writing what became a very controversial but still useful and insightful book called I, Rigoberta Menchú, which is a sort of autobiography, but is also a political history. And as I mentioned earlier, she was the Nobel Peace Prize winner in 1992. She's a controversial figure in Guatemala. Without getting into a discussion of the internal politics of Guatemala, I will say that she's a controversial figure in non-indigenous circles, a controversial figure in indigenous circles, but today in 2007 she is beginning a campaign for the presidency of Guatemala. Guatemala will have presidential elections next fall. And it will, of course, be interesting to see how that plays out, her campaign and those elections. I'm not going to have time to talk about all the different groups that I had hoped to. I think it is important to talk about women of different areas, and indigenous women of Mesoamerica by no means are representative of all indigenous women of Latin America, because the geographic, cultural, and national histories of each of the areas I mentioned earlier are different. What I do want to talk about is to talk about some of the conclusions that can be drawn about indigenous women generally, and then I want to talk a little bit about some of the issues involved in trying to study the history of women who may not themselves be literate, because that raises certain kinds of issues. And then I want to talk a little bit about what the future might bring for Native women. In terms of understanding the history of indigenous women in Latin America more generally, first I would say that for every area that I have talked about or that I could talk about, Native women have a long history of performing productive labor, though how we might define productive labor varies. They have a long history of performing productive labor, and as I argued in a previous class, the amount of labor they perform, the amount of work they do, has increased over time. Again, I'm not saying that they work more than men. I'm saying that if we look at their patterns of labor over time, their amount of work has increased and intensified. Also, I think we can conclude that while the degree to which women are politically active varies, in many parts of Latin America, in both the past and present, women have played roles in community, political, and religious structures of authority, and they've played roles in agitating for change. Another conclusion that can be drawn is that while families, households, and kin structures have often offered women sanctuary and support, both emotional and material, male, female, as well as parent-child relations can be marked by tension, even violence. And what's important about that point is that family and household can be a shelter in the storm, but it can also be the source of the storm. And that makes dealing with the problem of domestic violence. That's one of the reasons that dealing with the problem of domestic violence is very difficult. Finally, I want to say, and I think this can be concluded to some extent from the points I've been making about the specific ethnic groups and women's roles within those groups that I've talked about, but this also speaks to the patterns of change that I'll mention briefly. Globalization is important in understanding what's happening with women and men in indigenous communities in Latin America, and I think for women, globalization has had a contradictory impact. On the one hand, globalization simply speeds up change. It enmeshes indigenous communities and families ever more deeply in market forms of production and exchange. It intensifies the exploitation of female labor. And it undermines complementarity in male-female relations. At the same time, globalization brings with it new forms of political organization, as well as access to international aid and worldwide media. The Zapatistas, one of the incredible factors that led to the Zapatistas becoming so well known was their very skillful use of the media. And globalization and the existence of a globalized media makes that possible. Zapatista women played an important role in that because Zapatista women understood that they could mobilize support from women's groups outside of their own area in Mexico and from outside of Mexico. And they did it, again, very skillfully. And when I say very skillfully, I am not being cynical. I'm saying that they had a capacity, they had an understanding that that was a useful strategy, and they had a capacity to put that strategy into action. And when I talked about Nahua women not being as organized, that in part is what I'm referring to. You may well know about some of the struggles or issues affecting Zapatista women. You probably don't know too much about the struggles and issues affecting Nahua women because you, by and large, probably haven't heard about them. And there are reasons for that, and globalization, I think, is good and bad, plays an important role in that. Globalization, especially globalization of the means of communication, means that to a greater extent than ever before, Native women can help shape their own images, and they can give voice to their ideas, hopes, and agendas for change. And they can do that in a variety of contexts, local, national, and international. These trends began in the 1990s, and they will only accelerate in this century. And these trends will have a deep impact on Native women and gender roles within and beyond Native communities. For Native women, there is and will be in the future, I would predict, a growing tendency towards activism. Secondly, there is an increase in the numbers of and roles for female Indigenous leaders. And third, women have had and will have an increasing ability to make their voices heard and to play a greater role in shaping their own images. Rigoberta Menchú was crucial in helping that change to come about. While she dictated her memoir, which was, as I said, both an autobiography as well as a history of her community and a history of her region in Guatemala. She may have dictated that, her memories, to somebody else who wrote them down, even though she was herself literate. But in doing so, she made her own voice heard and laid the basis for her own role in some of the changes that are taking place in Guatemalan politics. Tracing out these changes is not an easy thing to do, because the kinds of sources that historians typically would use are not always useful when doing women's history, especially when doing Indigenous women's history, where many women are not themselves, and certainly in the past, were not themselves literate. So it becomes a struggle to find their voices. Ethnographies are one of the sources that allow us to trace some of this history, as I've tried to do here today. If globalization has worsened gender inequalities for Indigenous women and for women in many parts of the world, the scope and scale of Latin American Indigenous women's activities and assertions of agency in the current period is also unprecedented. And as these and other women demand representation, rights, and education, they'll gain an ever greater capacity to organize, and they'll play an ever greater role in the politics of their own communities and their nation states. And I'll stop there for now.